Good evening and welcome to this edition of the Speakers and Leaders Hour. I'm your host, Dave Wilkins, and this is the program that comes into your home once a month on the first Tuesdays from 7 to 8 p.m. here on cable channel 57 or 27 if you have Fios. I'm sitting here with a group of friends of mine from the Toastmasters organization as well as the Parliamentary Club, and I'd like to introduce them at this time. At the far end is Patricia Knaebe. And Patricia is an area governor in Toastmasters, and she's been around for some years now and is doing just a wonderful job. Next to Patricia is the Division B governor, and this man is serving his second term as Division B governor, and that's Bob Norris. And Bob, thank you for being here this evening.
Thank you for having me.
And rounding out the panel is our own Tom Howler, who is the current president of the new Speakers and Leaders Toastmaster Club. And myself, Dave Wilkins, I serve as parliamentarian for District 11 this year, as I have for the past 17 years. And we're here to talk about leadership. We're here to talk about communication. Hence the title of the program, the Speakers and Leaders Hour. The first topic we're going to discuss, of course, is Toastmasters, and that is with the Toastmaster organization, a group that's been around since 1924. They came into being at the behest of a giant of a man named Dr. Ralph Smedley. And we'll probably hear more about him a little bit later on. But what is the Toastmaster organization? What is the experience here in Fort Wayne? I would imagine that it's different for each person. But generally speaking, people have come together for the purpose of improving themselves in communication, an effective oral communication, actually, or in leadership skills. And having said that, I think that each of us have come for a different reason, but primarily we do give speeches, and then we learn by evaluation. So tonight I'm going to serve as your Toastmaster, and the first person I'd like to introduce to give their speech is our own Bob Norris, who I indicated is a DTM, who is our Division B governor and also is serving as Area 21 governor. He joined Toastmasters in 2007 and belongs to three clubs in the Fort Wayne area. That's not uncommon for people who are really dedicated to the organization. So tonight's speech is from the Competent Communicator Manual, project number 7, and that is Research Your Topic. His speech is about the recent rebranding of Toastmasters International. With the speech title of Why the Change, let's welcome Bob Norris.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and most honored guests at home. Why the change? For many years, Toastmasters as International has been acknowledged as the number one choice for developing and maintaining your speaking skills. Why? Because Toastmasters is really the only organization that has an ongoing curriculum and a built-in audience to help you practice your speaking skills today, tomorrow, and into the way into the future. Toastmasters International has long been known as the group that helps people improve their public speaking skills. Now, Toastmasters, over the years, through different clubs, different districts, different groups, has created websites and materials that started to flow differently. Rather than staying with the exact theme of Toastmasters, they started varying. So early in 2008, it became clear that everyone needed to kind of come back together and focus on the central point of Toastmasters. Because what was happening is you would go to one area of the country, say California. You would go to another area such as New York. And things would say Toastmasters, but they wouldn't look alike. And with a brand, one of the most important things is consistency. Just like probably those of you that recognize the arches. If you go to McDonald's in one area of the country to another, there is consistency. So World Headquarters in 2009 recognized it was time to come back to a consistent viewpoint. What does Toastmasters mean to everyone? What does it mean to you, to me, to the folks across the country, and to the folks around the world? So they decided to do some research. And the research was comprised of interviews with members, prospective members from around the world, because Toastmasters is an international organization, And they went through conferences, meetings, different countries, and said, what should our message be? Because the primary message all along has been on building your speaking skills. And that's probably where most of us started out with, is how to be better speakers, because we can all improve. But they also learned out of this, though, the mission should be to, quote, continually expand its worldwide network of member clubs, therefore ever offering greater numbers of people the opportunity to benefit from its programs. And to do this, a clear and consistent brand was needed to be created, so the organization, again, wherever you went, was represented the same way. Again, if you went to Michigan, you saw Toastmasters, you went to Florida, it all was recognizable as being the same product, the same services. So to achieve this goal, World Headquarters decided they would develop a set of tools to help clubs and districts around the country and around the world to consistently share this idea. Partly what they did was get together and say, now we're going to put a consistent set of items, badges, logos, emblems, materials that all say the same thing. We're all going to be on the same page. Now, part of this is because it will garner more recognition, garner more coverage, and additionally create a member experience that is consistent, that again, if you travel to one state, it'll be the same as the others. Kind of, again, like when you have a national brand like McDonald's or Starbucks. You create the experience for everyone, regardless of if they go here or if they go there. It's all the same. And the new rebrand is more than just simply a change in logo and colors. It's presented with everything we do. And one of the key points of this that I'll talk a little bit about very soon is the emphasis on leadership. Because great leaders are made. They're not born. Because people learn how to be a leader. If we could all be born as a leader by taking a pill, wouldn't that be wonderful? Because then we wouldn't have to go through all those painful learning experiences that we all experience in the world. But yet that doesn't happen. And Toastmasters decided for a new tagline as of August 2011. This motto would be, quote, where leaders are made, end quote. And this is the new brand. Because if you think about it, great leaders are effective communicators. They effectively communicate verbally. They effectively communicate in their written skills. Because you can have the smartest person in the world working on something, but if they can't communicate that to the people that need that communications, it's not going to work. The message won't get across. So as I talked about, a key element of the new Toastmasters international brand is the renewed focus on leadership. And to deliver this, it's essential we communicate what leadership skills are and how these skills can be acquired through Toastmasters. Again, leaders aren't born. It'd be great if we were, but we're not born. We are made. And most of the time, we are all a work in process. Taking that piece of coal, polishing it, putting it under pressure, and then creating it into a diamond, a gem that will stand above the ordinary everyday pieces of coal that you find around you. The following are examples of the skills and qualities as most leaders have. Leaders are emotionally mature. They are comfortable with themselves and accept their own faults and abilities. How many people do you know that aren't leaders, that the first thing that happens, they fly off the handle? They lose control of what goes on. Worse yet, what happens when they're confronted with a bad situation? Leaders, when they're confronted with something that's not working or a situation that might be puts them into a method where they're under fire, they can maturely handle the emotions that might spring up and take care of that crisis because they've had training. Leaders are free thinkers who are not afraid to disagree with the majority. The beautiful part about being in this country is we are encouraged for free speech. We are encouraged to think differently than the rest. Leaders are goal-oriented. You have to have a goal. You have to figure out where you're going. Otherwise, it's just a wish for where you want to be. Leaders are determined and will overcome all obstacles to reach their goals. You can have a goal, but if you don't think I'm going to do anything to accomplish it, then what happens is you just give up. But with the drive, the determination, you can do it. Leaders are willing to take risks and not afraid to fail. Leaders continue to perform despite delays, disappointments, distractions, and failures. Leaders inspire others to become leaders. And this is one part that I really like with Toastmasters, because being around the folks in Toastmasters has inspired me to step forward, inspired me to work to become a leader, to help others. I wasn't born a leader. They were all around me. I saw them as coaches. I saw them in the community. I saw them at work, at school. Leaders were everywhere. They were the heads of families. You don't really maybe think of a leader being head of a family, but they are. I admire these leaders. I thought, isn't this wonderful? But how do you become a leader? Where do you go? What classes do you take? Then along came Toastmasters. Well, Toastmasters was here to help me gain my voice, the ability to talk to all of you folks, the ability to have the confidence to feel safe, the ability to practice and know however I did it, people would be okay and that I was okay. I didn't have to worry about someone critiquing me because they evaluate me to give me confidence and courage. Toastmasters has now taken the next step with our rebrand, our refresh, and they said, let's focus on making leaders. Leaders are now the part of Toastmasters we can all strive for and all talk about, because leaders have an effective voice. Toastmasters can give you that effective voice that allows you to be part of the organization that says, come to us. This is where leaders are made. Mr. Toastmaster.
Wow, very good. Thank you very much, Bob. What an interesting synopsis of what is going on in the Toastmaster world today. And are you finding a lot of encouragement going from club to club with this new rebrand? Are they mostly liking it? Or?
I think most of them are. There is always a little bit of difficulty with change. Mm-hmm. But when you explain to the people why you're changing, how it's going to benefit them, how it will help them, how it will help Toastmasters and everyone, potentially even in our audience at home, it gives the opportunity to them for them to step back and say, yeah, you're right. This does allow us to grow. It does allow Toastmasters to grow, and hopefully everyone that comes to us in Toastmasters will be a part of this great change.
Exactly. Okay. Well, thank you very much. A very good presentation. It's easy to listen to and most informative. Now, when you're in Toastmasters and you give speeches from your prepared manuals, most of those projects are something that you will put together for yourself and that will be on a particular topic or a particular goal. Also within Toastmasters, there are preset workshops that Toastmasters asks that you or one of your members or one of your leaders will give to the group to assess what the group is doing and how they're succeeding. To that end, tonight we have Patricia Knaebe, and she is speaking on Moments of Truth. She's been with the Red Cross Club now 5 years. She is the Area 24 governor, her second term. She's a Advanced Communicator Gold and Advanced Leader Bronze. Those are Toastmaster designations for having done a lot of work, if you ask me. So with Moments of Truth, a close analysis, let's welcome Patricia Knaebe.
Thank you, Master Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and certainly guests at home. The Moments of Truth. Moments of Truth is a phrase that, believe it or not, Toastmasters did not coin. It was a phrase that was coined originally by a CEO of the Scandinavian Airline Systems. His name was Jan Carlson. And Jan Carlson took the Scandinavian airline systems from being one of the lowest ranked airlines in Europe to being the highest ranked airline in Europe because he managed those moments of truth. He took an airline that was very hierarchical, very structured, did not respond well to its customers, and streamlined it, made it very responsive to customers. One moment of truth that Jan noticed was that as his customers were sitting in their plane seats and they had a drink on the fold-down tray in front of them, that the rings that formed around that drink were indicators that there were engine problems. This was an aha moment for Jan. You can also call it a wow moment, or you can call it a why didn't I think of that moment. But Jan decided to call them moments of truth. And that's what we call them in Toastmasters, moments of truth. These are those little things, those little elements that we can bring to every single club to make the club a more personable club, a more enjoyable place, not only for members, but for our guests and our potential members. A club's goal is to maintain a membership of 20 members, and this can be challenging. But in order to actively recruit new members and maintain the member base that we have, clubs need to do certain things. They need to provide courteous service. They need to be attentive to their members' needs and their guests' needs. They need to offer capable service, and let me go so far as to say service excellence, to every member and every guest who walks into the door of the club. There are six critical moments of truth for a Toastmasters club, six areas where we as Toastmaster members and clubs have an opportunity to create that positive impression that is needed to grow a club and maintain a membership. The six critical areas of moments of truth include: one, first impressions. The second is membership orientation. The third is fellowship variety and communication. The fourth is program planning and meeting organization. The fifth is membership strength. And the sixth is achievement recognition. By using each of these six contact points, we as Toastmasters clubs and Toastmasters members can grow our clubs effectively and purposefully and have thriving membership bases. The first moment of truth, first impressions. What do we do when a guest walks through the door of our club? Do we greet that guest at the door? Do we introduce that guest to officers and fellow club members? Do we give the guest a name tag so we're not calling the guest, "Hey, you," during the club or during the meeting? We want that guest to also fill out an information form with contact information, an email address, a phone number, ways that we can contact this person and follow up to find out, are they interested in the club? Would they like to come back? We do want to invite them back for another look at the club. We want to make sure that our meeting room is set up professionally. We want to have an air of a business atmosphere at our club meetings in order to promote the leadership qualities and the leadership purposefulness that Bob Norris just talked about. We want to ensure that our meeting location is convenient for potential club members. We want to make sure it is accessible and that the meeting room is clearly marked. An excellent example of this is today when I walked into my Red Cross Toastmasters meeting. It wasn't held in the regular conference room where we hold it, but our sergeant at arms made sure that the receptionist at the front desk knew what meeting room it was in at the Red Cross and promptly told me, saw me walk in, identified me as a Toastmaster member, and said, "We're meeting in conference room H today," and gave me the appropriate directions to get to that room. This was very convenient. It would have been a wonderful convenience had we had any guests with us today. We do want to encourage our guests to participate in meetings. However, guests do come to meetings with a little bit of a nervousness, maybe a little bit of butterflies in the stomach. So we want to make sure our guests are comfortable. If they're not comfortable speaking at the first meeting, we do not want to push them into that role. We want to make sure they have a level of comfort before they stand up at the lectern and begin speaking. We would also want to invite guests to join the club when they come to visit. We don't want to let them walk out the door without expressing interest that we would like them to stay and be a part of our club and become a member. The second critical moment of truth is membership orientation. Once a new member says to us, "Yes, I want to be part of your club. Here's my money. Here's my fee for being a member of your club," we want to make sure that that member is provided with manuals so they can start working on their competent communicator level of speaking. We want to provide them with a membership pin, and we want to induct that member formally into the Toastmasters Club. We also want to immediately assign a mentor for one-on-one assistance. We want to make sure that that new club member has the availability of the knowledge of a member who has been with a club for a while to bounce speech ideas off of, to talk about possibly their fear that they're having in getting up and speaking for the first time. But that one-on-one assistance is very, very crucial to assisting that new member in meeting with success. I am currently a mentor for a new member of the Red Cross Toastmasters Club, and not only is it a great way to build a relationship with a new member, but it's also a super way to make lunch appointments and sit and have lunch and talk about speech ideas and help a member build speeches from scratch and watch a member grow into a wonderful speaker. We also want to discuss the educational programs that help develop the speaking and leadership skills. Again, today, the new member that I'm mentoring mentioned to me she is going to be Toastmasters for the first time next week and was nervous about doing it. After the meeting, she and I took a few minutes and talked about the role and its responsibilities, and she walked away feeling much more comfortable with that role and knowing that she had the ability to rise to the occasion and be our Toastmaster of our meeting. We also want to assign speaking roles for new members as soon as we can. Now, this gets a little tricky because we don't want to push them into it when they are saying to us, "I'm not ready yet." But when we have a confidence level, a base built, we want them to get up and speak. We also want to continue to make those new members feel welcome and encourage their participation in meetings. I've seen new members come into meetings and they will participate in table topics, which is one of our impromptu speaking sessions, and they will get up and speak for 10 seconds. And it's amazing to watch that growth as they become more competent and more confident in their ability to get up and speak. The third critical moment of truth is fellowship, variety, and communication. We've already talked about making members feel welcome and greeting our guests. We also want to make sure that our Vice President of Education puts on dynamic educational programs that have great themes to them. We also want to incorporate social events, open houses, ways that we can capture the media's attention and capture the attention of the community so people are interested in coming to the meetings. We want to encourage our club members to participate in the area contests, in the district, and the international events. We want to promote inter-club events as well and keep our website maintained and issue a club newsletter. Program planning and meeting organization is the fourth moment of truth. An important piece of program planning and meeting organization is beginning and ending meetings on time. Watching that time is very crucial. Membership strength is our fifth moment of truth. We want to maintain a minimum of 20 or more members, and that takes work to retain those members. We want to keep those members engaged and keep them coming back and interested in the group, in the club. And lastly, we want to bring achievement recognition to the table. When a member achieves a milestone in their development as a speaker and a leader, we want to make sure that we send those forms, those application forms, into World Headquarters in a timely manner. We want to congratulate those members, award them their pins during the club, and celebrate those landmarks in the club. In conclusion, the six critical moments of truth for a Toastmasters club include first impressions, membership orientation, fellowship variety and communication, program planning, meeting organization and membership strength, and achievement recognition. If clubs keep these six moments of truth in mind, they will flourish and maintain their club membership. Master Toastmaster.
Thank you very much, Patricia. I can see that you have put a lot of effort into that. And I know it's a full-hour program, so to have done it in 12 minutes and 32 seconds, you really did a lot of condensing.
Thank you.
But I think that you can all see out there that there's more to Toastmastering than just giving speeches. It's a very well-thought-out organization. And we're going to go to a break here in just a moment, but before we do, I'd like to have each of us mention our club that you belong to and when you meet. So starting with you, Patricia.
Okay. I belong to the American Red Cross Toastmasters Club. We meet every Tuesday at noon, and we are an open club. We are located at the Red Cross on California Road.
Okay, thank you.
I meet at the Bob Lyman Club, which meets the second and fourth Monday nights at Northcrest Pizza Hut from 6 to 8 o'clock. And I'm also a member of the Smoky Montgomery Club, which meets the second and fourth Tuesday nights at Lutheran Hospital.
And I'm a member of Club 521, the Anthony Wayne Club. We meet at Ivy Tech, the South Campus on Coliseum, room 1550. We meet every Thursday night. I'm also a member of the Advanced Leaders and Speakers Club, which meets the first Monday at one of the library locations at 6:30 Monday, first Monday.
Thank you. Thank you all. And I belong to the Bearfield Toastmasters that meets on Tuesday evening at 6:30. In fact, I have to say that I'm playing hooky for my club meeting right now so that I can be here putting this program together. We're going to take a quick break, and then when we come back, we're going to emphasize the leadership aspect of communication, and that we'll be talking about Robert's Rules of Order. So we'll see you on the other side of the break. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. And now for our next speaker, Stanley Lichner.
Speaking in public doesn't have to be a death sentence. At Toastmasters, we can help you overcome your fears.
I'd like to begin tonight with a little joke. This guy, he's a farmer, and he says... Hello? Sorry. But seriously, folks.
Speaking in public is no joke.
Chicken says...
For help, call Toastmasters, the public speaking support group.
The chicken.
All the education in the world won't help you get ahead in life if you can't express your ideas effectively. Every day, competition for advancement gets tougher and tougher. You need an edge. A Toastmasters club can give you that edge. A low-cost learning experience for men and women, Toastmasters gives you the confidence to express your ideas to anyone. Get the Toastmasters edge.
What future do you envision for yourself? What dreams do you have? If you want your dreams to come true, you must have confidence in yourself and your abilities. A Toastmasters club can help you build that confidence. A low-cost learning experience for men and women. Toastmasters shows you how to express yourself clearly and effectively. Make your dreams a reality. Join a Toastmasters club.
And the meeting will come to order. We're back now to talk about Robert's Rules of Order through the auspices of the American Institute of Parliamentarians, one of two parliamentary societies here in America dedicated to studying correct leadership using an authority such as Robert's Rules of Order. And with me on the panel are the two people from the Toastmasters Club, the area governor and the division governor, people who really need to develop their leadership skills. And then there's Tom Haller, a past member, a current member of the American Institute of Parliamentarians, president of the Toastmaster Club, the Advanced Speakers and Leaders Hour, and me, Dave Wilkins. Anyway, we're here to talk about Robert's Rules of Order. And this is, you know, we talked about the rebranding last half hour about Toastmastering. Well, as it happens, the parliamentary world has had a rebranding, as it were, this past month. They have had a new issue of this book. This is Robert's Rules of Order. This is the book that we have all paid homage to for the past 11 years. And it comes through the Robert family. They retain the copyright rights by reissuing it every 10 years. And now, here we are. This is the brand new Robert's Rules of Order, newly revised 11th edition. And can I get a ooh?
Ooh.
Ooh. How about an ah?
Ah.
Oh, these people train so well. Anyway, this is the new book. Now, what it is everything you wanted to know about how to lead a meeting is in here. But the tricky thing is to find it. And that's what we're going to study at our club meeting this coming month. And so to that end, I would suggest to anybody that has a copy of this to begin by perusing the index and also perusing the chapter headings. By doing so, you're going to get some notion as to the construction of the book and where you might actually be able to find things if you were ever needed to look them up. We've talked a lot about the history of Robert's Rules and who wrote it and why he wrote it. It was General Henry Robert. His picture was on the screen just a few moments ago. He retired in 1901 as a Brigadier General, United States Army Corps of Engineers. But in 1876, while living up in Wisconsin and Minnesota, he composed the first volume ever of Robert's Rules of Order, a small book of only 176 pages. And that was all that was needed. And he even had to pay for his own printing and publishing and binding because no one thought there was any need for his book. So he actually paid for the first 4,000 copies and thought they'd last for like 20 years. They were gone in 3 months. And so since then, it's been reissued and reissued and has become the gold standard for a leading procedure. And why is that, you might want to ask.
Why is that,
Dave? Why is that? I'm glad you asked. I want to tell you. Because he answered the question so completely and so thoroughly that no one had to re-answer them ever again. You see, prior to his book, there was a book by a man named Luther Cushing who left the rules ambiguous so that one section of the country might have Cushing's manual and another section of the country might have Cushing's manual too. But when they come together, even though they say we have the same parliamentary authority, they couldn't agree because on key points, Cushing did not flesh out what the answer was or the proper procedure was. They let each organization decide their own. And when they did that, they were coming up with hitting at the loggerheads rather than coming together as a group. And that was what Henry Robert did. He put down a list so clear and so comprehensive that since 1876, as I said, it has been the book that has been used by most societies. I thought that it might be fun for all the panel here if we just go through some of these questions. And what we do in our club setting is this. We ask the question out loud, and then we kind of discuss it, and then we come to a consensus as to what is the correct answer. So I think we'll just do that. Question number one. When a society adopts a parliamentary manual, such as Robert, the rules of that manual are blank upon it in all cases where they're not inconsistent with the bylaws or any special rules that have been adopted or any provisions of local, state, or national law applying to that particular organization. What that all says is that, well, is this book persuasive, pervasive, instructive, binding, or suggestive on the organization? And Tom, do you have any suggestions on this? Do you know?
Oh, I do know.
You do know, okay.
Yes, it's binding, and it's a matter of degree. Is it suggestive? Well, or instructive? It probably is, actually. But more to the point, it's binding on the members. They must obey it.
If it is part of their parliamentary authority. Right. And all of the rest of that there talked about inconsistent with state or local laws. You cannot have any rule in your organization that breaks any federal or state ordinance. That is just absolutely an anathema, and you cannot do that. All right, question number two. TSC, by the way, stands for the Standard Code. The Standard Code. And we kind of like skip those questions. So
there's nothing to do with Tractor Supply Company then.
TSC, Tractor Supply. Oh, very good.
I used to work for them.
Oh, okay.
Well, I was employed by them.
I see. All right. Okay.
Were they persuasive or were they binding?
They tried to be binding, but they were not persuasive.
Were they suggestive? Okay. Well, are we having fun now? A state chapter of the American Civil Liberties Union holds a regular convention bringing together several chapters. The state American Civil Liberties Union bylaws should establish a quorum for the convention, authorize a periodic convention, specify who will be authorized to vote, and prescribe the qualifications of delegates and alternates, or include all of the above. And if you think about those, I think the correct answer has to be
all of the above.
It's all of the above, because when you're holding a convention, you actually have special convention rules that are found in your parliamentary authority that are regular than just organizational rules. Okay. So that's the way that, that's why that is the question there. Okay, now which one of the following statements about a point of order is accurate? Is it debatable? It can be reconsidered. It requires a second. It is normally decided by the entire assembly. It can be applied to any breach of the assembly's rules. Which one is it?
I would say it would either be point B or point E, because I'm not sure the difference. Because if you are doing a program and you skip a point, someone in the group could say, point of order, you missed this, come back to it. So I'm not sure which statement would be the exact one. I don't know if that would mean be reconsidered or breach of the assembly rules.
I would think it would be E in all probability.
It is E, certainly. And the answers are on the next page, of course. But when you see the word reconsidered, that's a rather complicated maneuver to bring a motion back before the group to reconsider it. That's a bit beyond the pale of what we're trying to do here this afternoon. So, as you can see, the rules are many and varied, and to learn them, you simply just have to go through them over and over and over again. And in the final analysis, it is common sense. It really and truly is just common sense. If you don't know what to do, follow the golden rule. So that's it. All right, a motion to adjourn is always privileged except when it's qualified, as in a motion to adjourn at a particular time. When a time for adjournment has already been established. When there's no provision for another meeting, adoption of the main motion to adjourn would have the effect of dissolving the assembly. Or C is the only correct answer, or A, B, and C are all cases in which the motion loses its privileged status. Well, you don't know the difference between a privileged motion, an incidental motion, or a subsidiary motion. So I think that you're going to be way out of your league right now with a question like that. So unfortunately, I should
take a stab at it, Patricia.
Yeah.
Well, you're right. I don't know the difference between those three motions.
Okay, well.
Would you mind explaining?
Yeah, that, you know, this might be a good time. There are three broad classifications of motions. There are incidental motions, subsidiary motions, and privileged motions. And they're ranked in a stepping stone, not by what they do, but the order of importance that they're in. For example, a subsidiary motion is one that molds and shapes and perfects a main motion so that when it is finally brought before the group to be voted upon, everybody in the group is happy with it and they're going to vote and probably vote in the affirmative. That is a subsidiary motion. Subsidiary means to help or to assist. An incidental motion is just that. It's incidental to the business being handled. It doesn't help decide anything. It's, as I said, incidental. It has no particular rank. Each one is equally ranked. It might be a motion to divide the question into two parts, or it might be a motion to read a letter, or a motion to object. Those are all subsidiary, those are all incidental motions. Okay, and then the privileged motions, they don't have anything to do with the business or the making of the motion. They are there for the health and well-being of the organization itself. And such as a privileged motion would be to turn the heat up or turn the sound down, or can we take a recess or can we adjourn? All of those are motions of privilege, of asking the group, because make me feel better or make me more comfortable what I'm doing. So privileged, incidental, and subsidiary are the three branches. And so when it says a motion to adjourn is always privileged, that means, well, let me see what the answer is and I'll tell you. How about that? That's going to be too complicated for you guys. I apologize. When a motion to adjourn loses its privileged status, it becomes subject to amendment and debate, specifying, for instance, the time and place of the next meeting. Robert, but not standard, makes a motion to fix the time to which to adjourn, a motion of higher precedence. Ah, okay. That's just too difficult for us right here, right now.
Well, Dave, sir? I'd like to take a moment to remind the audience at home that we are on live. So if someone wants to call in and they have a question, especially about parliamentary procedure, I know you'd be most happy to answer it for them.
Well, you know, we could sure give it a shot. and that's true, whether Toastmasters or parliamentary, either one, we would be happy to answer that. And while we're talking about taking a moment, I'd like to tell you that the Parliamentary Club meets the third Monday of the month here in the main library downtown Fort Wayne. We're meeting in the Globe Room. If you come up from the basement in the elevator or the parking garage, as soon as you come inside, the Globe Room is just to your left, just beyond Children's Services. And we meet there the third Monday of the month from 6:30 until 8 p.m. We'd love to have you come. We study these questions. We do lecturettes. We have displays. We do all kinds of things, all relative to Robert's Rules of Order. And other parliamentary authorities, too, I have to say. Do you have any comments you'd like to add, Tom, at this time?
No? Not really. Are we skipping 7 and 8?
Well, you know, they're talking about the standard code again. And let's do 7. An appeal from the decision of the chair is given the unusual right to interrupt a speaker, since it must be made immediately or not at all. It must be stated by the chair as an unbiased question, such as those in favor of sustaining the ruling of the chair say so-and-so, or is debatable. The presiding officer does not need to leave the chair while offering his reasons for the ruling. The majority or tie vote sustains the chair's decision, or all of the above statements are accurate.
I'm guessing that logically it would be E that probably would.
Yes. And this is something that people might not know. Supposing your organization takes a vote on something and it comes out a dead tie, what can you do or what should you do about a tie vote? Do you have any thoughts on that at all?
in some instances, isn't someone appointed as a tie-break or vote? For instance, like in the legislature, I think that someone is designated as the person that would be the...
I think it's more apt to happen in a speech contest than in the legislator.
Well, that's possible,
in our Toastmasters contest, of course, we have to have a tiebreaker because we have to have a clear winner. However, according to parliamentary authorities, a tie vote is a no vote. So it doesn't pass. Because a tie vote, a majority vote by very definition has to be one more than half.
What would happen if you had a no vote, but enough of the people were not happy that it was a no vote? Would they be able to present that motion again in that meeting, or would they have to wait to another meeting or another time or reword it?
Well, if the tie vote is a no vote, then
it's done?
It's done at that time, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, there is a way to reconsider it, but not immediately. It has to be done later on.
Okay.
And
now, sometimes it would be possible that the presiding officer could then cast a vote, assuming that he would like to be really, really unpopular. He could do that.
Well, and the reason he would be unpopular, Tom?
Well, he's decided for the... I mean, he's made half the club mad.
Exactly. So as a presiding officer, you have the right to vote. But it'd be ill-advised if you do. So you have to try to maintain that air of impartiality. So that's the important thing to do. Okay. Mm-hmm. An appeal from the decision of the chair, what that means is that the chair has made a decision and you don't like it. So you appeal from the decision of the chair. And why is it that... majority or tie vote sustains the chair's decision. Why would a tie vote sustain the chair's decision? Because it's assumed the chair would vote for himself and thus break the tie. And so everybody's given one chance to speak. The chair states why they give the reason that they do. And then the person who is thinking the chair is unfair answers back. Then the chair has one more chance, and then the re-vote is taken.
Okay. I think C is interesting. Typically, when the presiding officer wishes to join the debate, he has to leave, as I understand it, correct me if I'm wrong, he has to leave the podium or his position of presiding and turn it over to a secondary officer, then go out in the audience. Here, there's an exception to that. He can
They're making the specific notice there at C that the presiding officer does not need to leave the chair while offering his reasons for the ruling. I think it would probably interrupt the flow of business too much.
I'm sure it would.
Yeah. I think that would be the reason why. But, okay.
And besides which, we no longer have much pretense of impartiality. It was his vote. You know, it was his decision that they're discussing, so...
Exactly. Yeah, and we don't even know what the decision was, but I suppose it would have been a vote. It could have been it would have been some kind of a vote.
Well, it says an appeal from decision of the chair, so we know where the chair stands. So.
Yes, okay. So the chair is on one side, and obviously somebody else is on the other. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, this is interesting, and you might not know this one. The Assembly has authorized the presiding officer to appoint members of a special committee. How does Robert say the chair of that committee is determined? In naming committee members, the presiding officer names the chairman first. Or, since the Assembly authorized the committee, it should name the chair. Or, the chair calls for nominations and has the Assembly elect the chair. Or the presiding officer uses a fill-in-the-blank procedure to determine the committee chair. And E, the chair appoints the convener and the committee elects its own chair. Well, if you've looked ahead, you probably know the answer.
So,
okay.
It would be A.
It is A. And do you know why that is?
That's a good question.
Because generally speaking, if something is being discussed within a group, mm-hmm. and somebody raises their hand and says, Mr. Chairman, I think that we need to have a committee to put the picnic together for next spring, the chairman's going to say, I agree with you. I think that's a great idea, and we want you on the committee. And so immediately, he's the chair of the committee.
So be careful what you ask for.
So be careful what you ask for. You know, when you stick your neck out, cool.
Yeah.
I have a question for
sure,
you, though, Dave.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Why is the answer not E? Because when you put a committee together, many times the committee wants to elect their own chair.
It could go that way. This is not cast in stone. I mean, if they said, you know, we'd like to elect our own chair, if that's okay. I'm certain that if it's a large enough committee, I think that the chair would probably go along with that. Absolutely.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
All but one of the following are advantages of committees, which does not fit the set. Greater freedom of discussion is possible. Domination by the chair is unlikely since he must remain neutral. Procedure in the comparatively small group can be quite informal. Hearings may be held to allow members to express their opinions. Delicate questions can be discussed away from the glare of publicity. Which one does not fit the set?
I would think B. I would think that would be one of the differences between a meeting of the whole and a committee.
That's right, exactly right.
Can participate.
Yeah. And in fact, a committee of the whole or a executive committee when of a group, say, like with a Toastmaster Club, you would have seven people in that committee or up to seven people in that committee. Each person has the right to throw out ideas and discussion, and no one is limited to how often they can speak, and the chair can speak and can speak for and against it in that committee setting, not necessarily before the group.
So. When you have a committee that votes on certain things, like a steering committee maybe or something, is it wise to have an odd number of people, like five or seven or nine, in the event they vote on something, they don't get tied, or does that ever happen?
Yes, that has happened, and Robert is, I think, rather silent. I haven't seen it in the Newman yet, but five, an odd number on a committee is an ideal number, simply because you will not have to be deadlocked. However, if your committee is large enough, it may be, and if it's contentious enough, the losing side of a committee may want to give a minority report to the organization.
Mm.
And that can be allowed to, or has to be allowed to. So.
Okay.
So. Yeah, I assume that could happen anywhere, but you see it in the federal, in the federal government. All the time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. And do you know what an ex officio member of a committee is? What that means? It's a Latin-y sounding term, so what does it mean?
He used to be a member of the committee?
An ex officio member is elected by the assembly or appointed by the chair.
Oh.
An ex officio member has the same rights as any other member except the right to vote. An ex officio member is best identified as a consulting or advising member. It's advisable to make the presiding ex officio member a member of all committees. An ex officio member has the same rights, responsibilities, and duties as any committee member, including the right to vote.
I would think that abbreviation of the Latin ex officio would be because they're more of a consulting or advisory member.
Yes.
And they would not be a voting member of the group.
The words ex officio mean by virtue of.
Okay.
So like the past president is by virtue a member of the executive committee just because of the advice he can give.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an example of by virtue of. So I would say C would be the answer there.
Mm-hmm. Oops.
E.
Oops.
Very good. Including the right to vote.
Well. Hmm.
but it's not counted as determining a quorum. Okay, well, we've got a few questions here tonight. We do this in the club as part of a club setting, and I think that we do it well. I want to thank you for participating tonight. This has been fun. We're down to the last 2 or 3 minutes, so let's give everybody a Boy Scout minute or a Girl Scout minute to talk about either your group or what's been going on this evening. So, Patricia, please.
Well, I would like to thank you for inviting me this evening, and thank you for allowing me to speak about the moments of truth. It is a passionate, passionate topic of mine. Please, if you are watching and you would like to join Toastmasters and would like to be a guest at the American Red Cross Toastmasters Club, you're welcome to join us every Tuesday at noon at the Red Cross on California Road.
Thank you, Patricia. Bob.
Thank you for having us here. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And like Patricia, if you would like to visit, I belong to the Bob Lyman Club on the second and fourth Mondays of the month, the Smoky Montgomery Club, the second and fourth Tuesdays. Guests are always welcome to visit for free. Should you become a member, and we hope you will, it's a very, very small cost. It is probably the best value for your money, I think, that is available in the world today. This is an opportunity for when you invest in yourself to make yourself better for yourself, for your community, for your and your family.
I, too, would like to thank Bob. Excuse me. Bad night for names. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I would like to encourage everyone to go on the web and see all the different Toastmaster clubs that are available, not just the ones that are represented here, but there are many others, meet all times of day and practically night. So whatever works for you would work for us.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, Tom. And I want to say some thank yous, and I also invite you to come to the Bearfield Club or the Anthony Wayne Club. And I want to thank Bob and Patty Hunter. Thanks, guys, for being here. You really helped make the program go. Of course, Paul Branson, old mainstay. Paul, thank you for helping out, as you always do. We've come to rely on Dennis Osborne way more than we ever thought we would, and Dennis is just a delight to work with and a real help when it comes to Toastmasters, computers, and television. And, of course, the lovely Elizabeth Lord, who helps get us on the air. Thank you. Also, Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Library, and you folks at home for watching. So thank you so much. It's been a joy having you here this evening, and we would like to see you next month on the first Tuesday of the month, which will be on November the 1st, I believe it is. Yes, November the 1st, we'll be back here on the Tuesday evening. And remember, our next parliamentary club meeting is the 17th of October here in the Allen County Library. Until then, thanks for watching. May all your meetings be fair and efficient. Good night.
Very clean.